Welcome to another post-game edition of the Devil Train Podcast. I'm your host, Ralph Amsden, up here, as always, with Chili. We are in the press box at Sun Devil Stadium, 34-31 win for Colorado. Let's just get right into your instant reaction. What do you think of this game? What went wrong for Arizona State?
Early on, I know people thought that the sky was falling and stuff with the way the defense was playing, giving up a lot of third down conversions and things like that, and it looked like Colorado was, in fact, you know, dicing up the Sun Devils defense, which they kind of were. But I think it was like kind of like a, you know, like a first date. They're kind of feeling it out, trying to see, you know, where things were going to go. I think Coach Gonzalez was hoping that trying to figure out how his 33 stack was going to work against this Colorado offense and how he was going to try to manipulate schemes to try to figure out a way to slow Colorado down, which I feel like he did in the second half. He just kind of got started a little bit too late. You know, the Sun Devils find ways to lose, and they do so spectacularly. Last year, San Diego State, and now this year, Colorado. You know, I'm disappointed. The fashion that we lost, you know, the roughing the holder. Like, I don't know if I've ever seen that call made. I mean, only in the Pac-12, right? You know, the touchdown that Colorado caught that really shouldn't have been a touchdown. The Eno Benjamin clipping thing, like, that guy was so behind the play that I don't even know if that block really helped at all. It's disappointing. It's just a disappointing close loss.
Yeah, I think that there were some coaching decisions that were interesting in this game, but at the end of the day, Arizona State's defense got torched by a Colorado team that realized, I think that drive that Michigan State went on at the end of the game last week exposed that Arizona State was soft in the middle. And I heard a couple of people talk about that as no, that drive was just indicative of Ashari Crosswell being out of the game at that point. But personally, I feel like after watching this game and watching Colorado run some bunch formations and work in some stuff over the middle again and again and again and again, that Arizona State actually has some things that they need to fix on this defense. They were not able to pressure Steven Montez. He had the most efficient game maybe of his entire college career, 23 of 30, 337 yards and 3 touchdowns. On third down, this Colorado team was unstoppable, it felt like. I mean, it says they were 10 for 17, but it felt like they were 17 for 10, if we're being honest.
Yeah, mostly in the first half, though, because I think, like, midway through the third quarter, I think Gonzalez had it figured out. Like I said, I think that, you know, he just figured out a little bit late. And this is the Pac-12. This isn't the FCS. Like, hey, man, like, you got to figure things out fast. Like, you have halftime, but you don't have until halftime to make these adjustments. Like, you got to figure this crap out, like, in the first quarter so that you know how to stop it in the second quarter so you can readjust other things at halftime. This is a problem. The defense has been an issue, and it's not just under Gonzalez. This has been going on for years. So I think, you know, the defense is going in the right direction. Just Gonzalez, you know, has to move a little bit faster, has to work a little bit faster. And, you know, do I think that some of the, you know, oh, he's going to, you know, carry on for Herm Edwards. Do I think some of that is a little premature? Yeah, I think it's a little premature. I think, you know, him becoming the mayor of Tempe is a little premature. But, I mean, so is the fire Rob Likens stuff. When Rob Likens needs to put points on the board, look what happened. He put points on the board. I mean, do you want to lose scoring a bunch of points, or do you want to win ugly? I'd rather win ugly. A lot of people were mad about that Michigan State situation, but I would have taken one of those wins over what we saw tonight. Losing spectacularly does nothing for me.
Yeah, I mean, I think we're probably about to get into our typical position-by-position breakdown, but let's talk about some of the plays that made a real difference in this game. First of all, you have Tony Brown, who absolutely went off today. He had 150 yards receiving. He had 3 touchdowns. He had 2 that were just right on Jack Jones's head. Like, I'm not sure that Jack Jones could have done any better job than he was doing in coverage when those two touchdowns happened. But fate sort of smiled upon Arizona State. Laviska Shenault goes out early in the game. Steven Montez did all this damage to an Arizona State defense that had given up 7 points 3 weeks in a row without what I believe to be the best offensive player in the entire Pac-12. And, I mean, Tony Brown's never done this before. Tony Brown had 150 yards receiving coming into this game. Tony Brown is a senior. Tony Brown has never had a season that would indicate that he's the type of receiver who could go off like this. He had 13 catches in 2015 at Texas Tech, 13 catches in 2016 at Texas Tech, sat out 2017, and then when he was playing even full-time last year, he had 333 yards receiving total, 10.4 yards a catch. He was a possession receiver, and he came out here and he dominated Arizona State. What the hell happened?
You know, I think losing Shenault, Colorado went with their next man up mentality. Yes, he is a 3-4 receiver, but, you know, I think he just happened to be the next guy up. He got hot, and, you know, he obviously started clicking with Montez very, very quickly, and he's the one that did all the damage. Somebody was going to do it, whether it was him or, you know, one of their other guys. Like, somebody was going to do the damage for them. And, you know, Nixon had a great game. I mean, you know, who knows? Like, if it wasn't Brown, it was going to be Nixon. If it wasn't Nixon, it was going to be, you know, somebody else. And it's just disappointing. It's frustrating. It's so frustrating because, you know, as Sun Devil fans, we just want to see a little bit of consistency and balance from the two sides of the ball, and we never seem to get it. Either we're not getting enough points, or the defense isn't getting enough stops. And, you know, unfortunately tonight it was the defense didn't get enough stops.
So let's talk about the first quarter, because I felt like that was a really big deal. This is a Colorado team that didn't score in the first half against Nebraska. This is a Colorado team that only had 10 points in the first half against Air Force, who they lost to just last week. And they came out in this first quarter and they put 14 on Arizona State right away. And it wasn't like Arizona State wasn't also kind of moving the ball in that first quarter. It's almost like Arizona State came out and they were like, all right, we're going to be, so even though Colorado went out and got that 7 right away, in Arizona State's mind, it was, we're fine, we're going to go out there, be slow and methodical on offense. Then all of a sudden, Colorado gets the ball back and scores again. Did that worry you at all, or did you feel like that was something that they could come back from? I mean, eventually they did come back from it, but to me, it was a little bit concerning that a team that does all their damage in the second half was able to score 2 touchdowns against a team that had only given up 3 on the season in the first quarter.
My biggest concern, and, you know, I actually talked to one of our friends of the show, Tressa Tudrick, and I was telling her, I'm worried that the Sun Devils are going to come out flat, because the Sun Devils are notorious for getting ranked and then coming out flat the following game. They do it all the time. And, you know, there's so much that went on this week. Zendejas got his scholarship, and, you know, I was just worried about them coming out flat. Sure enough, missed a field goal. And I know it was from 48 yards out, but still missed a field goal, left those points on the board. And, you know, like I said, there's a big Frank Darby drop. There was the, you know, Benjamin score that wasn't. You know, there was just a ton of things that went on. And, you know, we find ourselves in a 14-0 hole, and we have to dig ourselves out of it. And we did. You know, we scored our touchdown, and then we got our break on special teams, recovered that fumble, good field position, scored again, and it's 14 all. But if the Sun Devils don't come out flat, and I think, you know, it's a young team, so, you know, they're still on that hangover from Michigan State. Emotional game, and, you know, you saw how amped up Chase was. So, like, you know, I think that the Sun Devils team just, you know, they still had the hangover, and they got to learn that you can't do that and have consistent success.
So Arizona State tied this game up at the beginning of the fourth quarter, And then I believe it was the fourth quarter that they were driving and Jaden Daniels threw an interception. Yeah, I mean, he had a big game, and we're gonna get into our position by position breakdowns like we usually do here in a moment. But Arizona State had moved the ball pretty well there, and then they just kind of quit being able to move the ball. Colorado had a long methodical drive; they get a field goal out of it, and it puts Arizona State in a position where Colorado knows that they can just pin their ears back and rush the passer. And you know, Jaden Daniels misses on a couple of throws, or you know, we could put it on a receiver if we need to. Eno Benjamin kind of bobbled a ball, but Colorado knows what's coming, and they're able to hit Jaden Daniels on third down, get him to the ground, and on fourth down, they're able to get to him almost immediately. Arizona State is in a situation where they have two timeouts left. Colorado gets the ball deep in Arizona State territory. They force a field goal, and then right before the field goal is kicked, Arizona State's coaches call Chase Lucas to the sideline, who a lot of the time is the edge rusher on field goal team, and they send out to Marcus Davis. To Marcus Davis hits the holder for Colorado, who flops, as holders and punters are told to do when there's contact made, and the refs go ahead and throw the flag, which effectively ends the game. I'm not saying that Arizona State would have even been in a position to be able to move the ball down the field in 40 seconds, but they're not afforded that chance. Is this more of a ref issue or maybe a decision that shouldn't have been made by the coaching staff in that moment?
I think it's kind of a combination of both. I mean, I really want to say that I think that was a terrible flag to throw. But it's also such a terrible substitution. Why in that moment would they make that substitution? Like, I get it, like, if we're up a score or whatever and you want to give Chase some rest, but what are you resting him for? Because the offense is going to come back on the field.
It would have been the last play of the game for him unless they were able to march down and kick a field goal. And I want to be very clear. It's not like it was a substitution package. They pulled Chase Lucas off the field. They pulled him off the field in order to put into Marcus Davis. Nothing against that kid, but obviously Chase Lucas has never hit a holder before, and he's been doing this going on 3 years of coming off the edge on field goal attempts.
It's just such a weird move to make, but I mean, you know, our coaching staff has 278 million years of football coaching experience, so I mean, you know, who am I to really like second guess them on, you know, our pro model of doing things? I mean, I guess, you know, stuff like that is done at the pro level, and you know, I can only support Coach Herm Edwards and, you know, decisions that are made. But it's actually a stunning decision that's made, because in that moment, like, I would think that you'd want your experienced player out there. Maybe Marcus Davis runs a little bit faster than Chase. I don't know the analytics of it, so it's disappointing.
And I've got a couple of other things that I want to question the coaches on, as far as, I mean, and like I said, we'll get into that. We might as well do it right now by starting off with the quarterbacks. First of all, I mean, let's start on Colorado's end. Steven Montez. One of my biggest fears with this Arizona State team was after watching them against Sacramento State and realizing while watching that game that if their quarterback had been accurate, that would have been a mess for ASU, especially with some of his downfield passes. Some of these receivers were blanketed, but it doesn't mean that an accurate quarterback isn't going to find a way to work it into the space that's available. And tonight we saw that. Steven Montez, I mean, it helped that Steven Montez had all day to throw, but he was threading the needle. And that's one of the things that I fear with this defense, is that Danny Gonzalez talked about wanting them to have like 20 interceptions, but not everybody, this defense doesn't really feel like it's in a position to get a bunch of turnovers unless the guy you're playing against is making mistakes. You're depending upon the opposing quarterback to be somebody who doesn't have great accuracy. Tonight, Steven Montez had great accuracy and an abundance of time to throw, and that's a poison pill, I feel like, for any defensive backfield.
I mean, Steven Montez, like you said, was 23 out of 30, so I mean, he's hitting on 80% of his passes, zero turnovers, zero interceptions,
zero sacks.
I mean, that you are ultimately creating a recipe for disaster. This, you know, this 3-3 stack that Coach Gonzalez uses, I don't want to say it's a gimmick, but it's very reminiscent of the 46, you know? And I think, you know, I don't want to tell him to change his scheme because, you know, I think it works. But
well, it worked against the run.
Yes. I just think that, you know, some adjustments need to be made faster. You know, you fall into that 14-0 hole and it seemed like there was still struggle in that second quarter. As soon as it's 7-0 and you realize like how quickly your team is getting cut up, I think that he needs to make decisions that, you know, impact the game and not to the detriment of the Sun Devils.
So you think this was more of a Sun Devil defense allowed for Steven Montez to go like superhuman, or do you feel like maybe it was more Steven Montez is an underappreciated Pac-12 quarterback?
Oh, I definitely think that Steven Montez is underappreciated. I think, you know, seeing what he did tonight, there's no other way to look at it. But you know, his top threat went out and he kept moving. He kept moving. So I definitely think that he's underappreciated. But I do think that he's not the Superman that, you know, the statistics paint him to be right now.
Right.
This is crazy.
Yeah. Let's jump over to Jaden Daniels. 4 games in a row. He's the man. I mean,
that's my quarterback. That's my quarterback. I said on Twitter, follow your guy, @JustChili. I said when he signed, he will be the starting quarterback for Arizona State. There's no question. He is going to be the guy for the next 3 or 4 years that he's here, and he is a guy that, you know, we can bet on, that we can trust. I sound like I'm orchestrating his presidential campaign or something, but, you know, in the past we've had quarterbacks that made poor decisions. This is a kid that you can tell is listened to everything that his coach has said. He slides when, you know, when he needs to. He runs out of bounds when he needs to. He's got great decision making. It took 4 games for him to throw his first interception. You know, he is poised and composed. He's great in the pocket. He's great outside the pocket. He can throw it away when he needs to throw it away. This is a very, very good quarterback that, you know, I think that Sun Devil fans are going to love for years, for the next, hopefully, for the at least 3 years. You know, I don't anticipate he's going to have to head to the transfer portal or anything like that, but 350 yards passing, like 2 touchdowns. I know 1 interception, and like the interception was just disappointing because like I don't understand who he was throwing to. I don't understand who he was throwing to because that guy was there. Like,
yeah, it was a slant route that was definitely blanketed. Ill-advised throw, which is going to happen sometimes. You can't expect.
Like, did he really think that he was going to make that throw?
And I think you get to a point where he had thrown well over 100 passes into his college career without throwing an interception. And I think stuff like that can make you a little bit brave. Now, this is a kid, he's on pace to throw for 3,219 yards as a freshman, like a freshman.
Yeah, I mean,
the most that Manny Wilkins ever threw for in a season, and this is including a bowl game appearance, was 3,270. So again, I'm not even including, I'm just saying regular season, 12 games, that Jaden Daniels is on pace to throw for over 3,200 yards. And we're just 4 games into his freshman season. He is definitely a special football player. Didn't get a lot of help from some people tonight, and we'll get into that. But I will say that there was one situation, and this is staying on the quarterbacks, that bothered me a little bit, and that was we've seen 2 games in a row, not including this game, 2 games in a row, where bringing Ethan Long into the situation to run the Sparky formation, but also he's a real quarterback, so it's not really the Sparky formation, but bringing in Ethan Long has caused problems for the offense 2 games in a row. Well, you come into it tonight, and
has it though?
Yes, Eno, they've had to call timeouts at inopportune times.
Okay, okay.
2 weeks in a row. Benjamin getting pissed off in both occasions. And then tonight, it's very clear that Jaden Daniels is your leader. He's your best player. He is your best quarterback. Tonight, they put Ethan Long in the red zone, and I think he ends up getting like a 3-yard run.
Right.
You know who else can get you a 3-yard run? Jaden Daniels. If you wanted to put, and let me finish on this one, if you wanted to put Ethan Long in the game in a crucial red zone situation, then what you're saying is he's the better player in that situation. And if he was the better player in this situation, he would be starting at quarterback. It's time for the Ethan Long experiment to end. He's played in 4 games. Let him take his red shirt because you might need him. You might need him. So he's your third string quarterback. 3 games in a row, it has not worked the way that you want it to work. Put it on the shelf and make sure that your actual quarterback who needs red zone experience stays in the game.
I disagree, and let me tell you why. I disagree because, you know, I think Ethan Long provides an opportunity to let a quote-unquote quarterback get banged up a little bit. You can kind of dent him up a little bit. It's okay. Hey, Ethan, go
it's
run.
It's okay
go,
if it works.
Go run for those hard yards. Go. If you get 3 yards, you're right. Jaden Daniels could get those 3 yards too. But Jaden Daniels might have to go in and get hit for real. We don't want Jaden Daniels to get hit for real. We want Ethan Long to be Captain America, put a shield on, and take that big hit. Yeah. That's cool because he's going to come back out the next play. Jaden Daniels is going to come in, and hopefully he can get whatever is left.
Here's my issue. Rob Likens was at Cal when Jared Goff was a freshman and Luke Rubenzer was a freshman. And they let Luke take those hits for Jared. They brought Luke in 7 to 10 snaps a game, and they let him take those hits. And eventually, Luke Rubenzer was what?
A safety.
A safety, exactly. They did it for a while, and it didn't work, and Rob Likens should know this better than anyone because he was at Cal while it was happening. And you have somebody who could be equally as special as Jared Goff was. And I realize I'm talking about the number one overall pick in the NFL draft, but that dude was legit, and Rob Likens was there. He wasn't the one making the calls. He was the wide receiver coach, but he was there, and he should know better that this will have to come to an end at some point. It might as well be now when you have a mountain of evidence that it's not doing what you want it to do. Not since the first series of the first game has this looked like it was a good idea.
But if Jared Goff, and I hate to jump into a whole different team, but if Jared Goff takes some of these Luke Rubenzer hits, Jared Goff might end up being like a 6th-round pick. He might end up being a CTE casualty.
Yeah, I mean, I guess you could try to throw the ball since he's the chosen one, and you should trust him.
You want to throw the ball on the goal line or within the 5-yard? I mean,
I don't know.
You know, all it didn't work so well. It didn't. Hey,
all I know is they took a field goal there when I felt like they could have
they don't
taken
work well
a shot.
For the Seahawks, that's what I'm saying.
Right. Well, they could have taken a shot with Jaden Daniels and tried to figure out if, because at some point Jaden Daniels is going to have to get this red zone stuff right. He's going to have to get it right.
I hear you, and I get the frustration. I totally get the frustration. But the only reason I'm not frustrated, and like I said, Jaden Daniels, that's my quarterback. The only reason I'm not frustrated is because if we're going to have somebody take those hits, I'd rather it's Ethan Long than Jaden Daniels right now. Not that I want to see Ethan Long, you know, whatever, but, you know, I'd just rather see him take those hits.
Yeah, I guess we're going to have to
agree to disagree.
I guess so. let's move on to, it surprised me to look at the stats and see that Eno carried the ball 20 times.
Okay.
Because I felt like that was an issue that they probably should have tried to force more. And he carried
20 is a lot of carries.
20 is a lot of carries. So, again, I was surprised because it did not feel like he was getting the ball. Let's just say I was surprised. He did get the ball 20 times.
What surprises you more, that he had 20 carries or that he only had 83 yards?
What surprises me more is that the formations that Eno's getting the ball out of are sort of like long developing spread type formations. When I think Nick Ralston leading this team did some serious damage, because they don't have anybody that they can trust at the fullback position. They tried Case Hatch out. He's better on the defense.
Yes.
They got a big dude who it's not working. It's just not working. I think Nick Ralston leaving hurt this team's ability to open things up for Eno Benjamin from a more traditional sense. And you end up having Colorado win the... Colorado cannot stop anybody on the defensive side of the ball. They didn't stop Arizona State tonight. They cannot stop anyone. And yet, having two freshmen on the offensive line kind of put Arizona State in a situation where Eno was only able to get 4 yards a carry against a team that he probably should have done some more damage against. I'm not upset at Eno. He dropped a I think maybe a one ball in the passing game and then had two catches for no yards. So he's not been effective in the passing game. They were splitting him out wide in different circumstances. So I don't really know what's going on there. But I will just say that I was surprised that he had as many carries as he did. And then again, we continue to see that Arizona State does not trust any of the running backs on this roster one iota beyond Eno Benjamin. And Rob Likens talked about developing players and putting them in crucial situations, but that doesn't seem to apply to the running back. This team has one running back, and no one is even being allowed to attempt to help.
Yeah, what happened to Floyd?
I'm sure that we'll hear about it on the Devil's Digest message boards, because that always becomes an issue, and I wouldn't, you know, you get to a point where you wonder if, you know, Demetrius Flowers is a big body, you know, maybe you try him out to at least give Eno a breather. A.J. Carter, you know, but it's just not, it just hasn't been happening. I am surprised. Or, God, just move Ethan Long for good and hand the ball off to him if you're going to have him out there anyway. So I was surprised that Eno had as many carries as he did when I looked at the stat sheet. What I was not surprised by is that Arizona State continues to have no help at the running back position beyond Eno Benjamin.
It's disappointing. I mean, it's definitely disappointing and surprising.
As far as Colorado's running backs, Fontenot ran 25 times for 89 yards. He looked good on the first drive of the game, and then Arizona State bottled him up. They bottled everybody up. Arizona State was really good against the run tonight. Colorado's running backs aren't that good anyway. The 3-3-5 works against teams who don't have a outright dedication to just running the ball up the middle all night. And so that's where you saw the 3-3-5 do its job tonight.
Going back to what you said a little bit earlier, you know, we kind of knew that ASU was going to be soft up front. We've got to be fair. We knew that, you know, some of that stuff was going to be a problem. We knew the defensive line was going to be an issue. This committee thing, like, it's tough, especially with kids. So, you know, I don't want people to think that the sky is falling just because, you know, some bad things happen up front. Like, get used to it for the short term. Just got to figure it out faster.
Yeah. At receiver, there were some things I was encouraged by tonight. I think Brandon Ayuk continues to step into that role as the guy.
He's going to torch Cal.
He is not going to torch Cal.
Because you're going to have to change your name to Ayuk Emerson.
Yeah, he's not going to.
Emerson Ayuk.
For anybody who wasn't listening, I said that if he has 150 yards receiving against Cal, I will change my middle name to Ayuk. I am not looking forward to this conversation with my wife. Thank goodness she does not listen to this podcast. But I mean, he had 9 catches for 122 yards tonight. I thought he had a very, very good game. I thought he was dependable. He didn't make every play that was available to him, but he is not the one that people should be concerned with at this point, because there are other concerns. Kyle Williams, 3 catches for 32 yards. He has regressed. And Frank Darby, the only thing consistent about Frank Darby is that he's inconsistent. He did not have a good game. He was not able to run out a ball that he probably should have caught.
Oh my God.
He had another drop on what would have been a big gain. When it was thought that Eno Benjamin fumbled, he was laying on it and found a way not to get the ball, even though Eno was down. But at the same time, it was just like, wow, everything is trending in an absolutely terrible direction for Frank Darby. And then guess what? He catches a spectacular touchdown pass, and then he's dancing in the end zone in front of the inferno, and then everyone's like, oh, you know, all is well. But all is not well. You forget that last year, had he held on to that ball, which I don't know how any human being would have been able to hold on to that ball against San Diego State at the end of the game, that it gives Arizona State a chance to stay in this game. He dropped a pass against Michigan State. He was constantly getting yelled at by Manny Wilkins for not finishing plays. When I said that it's time for the Ethan Long experiment to end, I'm ready for Arizona State to go ahead and bench Frank Garvey. I'm ready. And I know that he is the funny bone of this team. He is essential. He is vital to this roster. He means a lot to this team. But I think it's and I think that you actually started to see that's the reason Jordan Curley's on the field. Is that Frank's not necessarily getting it done to be able to be on the field for the entire game holding down that position. Because today you had catches by Ryan Newsom, who you rarely ever hear from. Ricky Pearsall had a catch. Jordan Porter had a catch. Curtis Hodges, welcome back, Curtis Hodges. He was doing some work over the middle of the field as his like hybrid wide receiver tight end position. You're having to depend on all these other guys because your two mainstays at receiver that are supposed to be alongside Brandon Ayuk aren't getting it done, and Kyle Williams, who more just sort of disappears than actually makes mistakes, and Frank Garvey, who is making several mistakes at this point.
I don't need Frank Garvey or Kyle Williams to be the Robin to Brandon's Batman. I need the collective of the seven receivers that we have to be the seven dwarfs to Brandon's Snow White. I need them all to chip in when it's time to chip in, you know. I need to see Curley pop off for, you know, a 60, 80-yard game, kind of like he did tonight. We needed that. We needed those 60 yards from him. I just need Frank Garvey to, you know, not drop all these passes. At least catch one. Catch one extra one. You know, Kyle Williams, like, you know, show up and have an 80-yard game. I just need one other person to get to that 80-yard mark, whoever it is. I don't care at this point because we are getting to a point where, like, we're almost, like, halfway through the season.
Yeah.
Football season goes quick.
Yeah.
So, like, we're almost halfway through the season. I need somebody, I just need, you know, dopey, sneezy, sleepier Doc to wake up and, you know, just help Brandon a little bit.
Yeah, I think one of the issues right now is that, you know, Frank Darby's the guy who apologizes with flowers. Like, you appreciate, I'm sure we appreciate the roses, right? It's a nice gesture, but, like, maybe don't make the three mistakes that require the roses for people to welcome you back into the home.
This isn't 51st Dates. I'm not 10-second Tom, so I'm not going to forget, like, that you dropped this big pass that, you know, should have put us in scoring position early. Like, I'm going to remember that, and I'm going to remember that for the rest of this game, and I'm going to remember that going into next week as a fan and, you know, as a supporter, and I want him to do well, but, like, if it's not going to be him, I just need somebody else to step in. And you're right, maybe it is time to bench Darby, and, you know, until he can get his hands right or concentration right or whatever, like, let somebody else step in and get that opportunity. Ricky Pearsall seems to be, you know, salivating for the moment, you know?
Yeah, I mean, Ricky can get some stuff done over the middle that it feels like Kyle Williams should be able to get done, and Jordan Curley pretty much is Frank Darby as far as being able to run that nine route down the field, but he showed that he's a little more versatile today too, and so it just makes you wonder if Arizona State's costing themselves by trying to get these big plays out of Frank Darby. You know, I want nothing but the best for that guy. He the team absolutely loves him, and again, like, he's a lot of fun and people like having him around, but it, just the mistakes are piling up, and it's going to get to the point where, you know, what is Vontaze Burfict remembered for at Arizona State? Even though he's had a very successful NFL career, people just think about his lack of discipline. Frank Darby could go on to have a great NFL career, and people are going to think back on his time at ASU as just like a bunch of miscues. And you don't want that, because this is a really, really talented kid. Maybe it's time for Jaden to get a little bit of that Manny Wilkins fire, start yelling at this dude. I mean, not like it was effective last year, but at the same time,
I don't think Jaden's that type of leader, though. I think he leads different. He's not Kobe. He's LeBron.
Yeah. Well, let's go ahead and talk about the offensive line. I feel like they did all right. There was obviously a couple of miscues toward the very end of the game, and Stephen Miller got called for clipping, which, I mean, one of those penalties that we're used to seeing at the high school level. You don't really get it too much in the pros. I thought the offensive line did fine tonight. I think they did enough to win the game. I think that they should be commended. A 17-year-old at left tackle, and he's getting the job done. I mean, good for him. Donovan West looks good. Stephen Miller's doing everything that he can. Cole Cabral is, you know, I think that, again, it's going to be tough for them to run the ball with this unit, and I think they're probably going to have a little bit more of a dedication to the run to get it done. But I can't really fault the offensive line for, I mean, like, they didn't look that great on Arizona State's last series. It was one of those situations where, like, an ASU offensive lineman tackled the guy who was tackling Jaden, who couldn't get away because he was sandwiched in between another offensive lineman. But again, that's what you ask for when you have to pass the ball on third and long.
I think that the Arizona State offensive line was actually better than the Colorado offensive line. I would say that, you know,
I disagree, but I will say they were both good.
I think that, you know, Colorado's offensive line got away with a lot of stuff because Gonzalez's defense just didn't work. I think that, you know, I don't know. I personally think that Arizona State's offensive line did their job better.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about Arizona State's defensive line. My biggest fear going into the season, and I said it a bunch, was that this defensive line is going to waste brilliant performances by the defensive backfield. All of my fears came true tonight. This defensive backfield, I mean, we're talking Steven Montez had up to 6 seconds to throw on several third and longs. And that you're going to get it done every time. If you're a competent quarterback and they give you 6 to 7 seconds to make a decision, you are going to destroy a defense. The whole thing is that this is supposed to work in conjunction, where you're able to pressure a quarterback within 4 seconds if your defensive line is doing its job, which means that your cornerbacks don't have to, and your safeties don't have to be in a position where they're superhuman. And tonight, the defensive line just did not get the job done. They were able to stuff Colorado on the run, but as far as just getting to the quarterback with a 3 or 4 man rush was not happening.
Yeah, and like I said, I think that, you know, this is where Gonzalez has to, you know, come in and make some adjustments a lot faster. He can't wait until the second half to make these changes. You know, I don't know what the solution is, but, you know, somehow he's just got to figure it out. And we knew that the defensive line was going to be an issue going into the season. We knew that it was going to be a committee, and we knew that there was going to be a heavy rotation. You know, we're in the season now. We're about halfway through. It's time to stop making those excuses. Like, we know what it is. Just got to get through it. And yes, there is a lot being wasted with our secondary and our talented linebackers and stuff like that. But, you know, golly, like, I just, it's painful. And I just want to see Gonzalez figure it out faster. There's got to be a way.
Right. I mean, and again, they did have 3 good games. Not great, but they did have 3 good games. The linebackers are what really seem to be absent right now, because a lot of what made people fall in love with Merlin Robertson was his ability to get into the backfield. We have not seen a whole lot of that. Tyler Johnson missed another game, nagging injuries. They missed him tonight, I believe.
Yes.
It's really fallen to sort of the safeties to be able to come up and make plays. Evan Fields has looked good. Arizona State's corners seem to be tackling well. I mean, it's almost to the point where the linebackers didn't do that much, so it's not even really worth talking about them. They don't really have somebody who can play over the middle against the pass, and not a lot of college teams do. So you're having to defend against a lot of slants and seam routes and things like that. And that can be really tough. And, you know, so, you know, from the safety position, Cam Phillips has been able to crash down and do well. Ashari Crosswell has been able to do well. Evan Fields has been flying all over the field the last couple of weeks. And the corners, you know, we didn't hear much from Kobe or Chase tonight because they were, for the most part, they were doing what they were supposed to do. It was Jack Jones who got beat on a couple of plays. And I'm starting to feel like Jack is out there to make plays. That's the benefit of having Jack Jones, is that he's the guy that can go out and make a big play. Chase and Kobe are more your guys that keep the quarterback from throwing the ball in the first place. But instead of Jack making big plays, he got burned a couple of times tonight. And I use the word burned very loosely because he was there. He was there and probably shouldn't have even been in the situation to have to defend passes that Steven Montez had all day to throw. But the back seven of this defense, after watching Steven Montez go to work today, do you feel like they're in trouble, or do you feel like this is a defensive line issue?
I do think it's a defensive line issue. It's got to be figured out up front. I think we're settled in the... I definitely think we're settled amongst our defensive backs. I think our linebackers are amongst the best in the conference, you know.
Do you think Jack Jones is getting too many reps?
No. God, he's good. I like him a lot.
Do those things happen if that's Kobe or Chase?
Man, that's tough.
You know, Jack, he did have a big play in the first half where he receiver caught a really long pass, and Jack made sure to hit him before he came down, and so the catch didn't count because it was out of bounds. I mean, that was a smart play by him, but also he's on film with two touchdowns getting scored on his head.
Man, I want to say that those touchdowns would have been scored on anybody, but like the short answer is against Chase, for sure not. I don't think that they would have been scored on Chase. Kobe, I'm 50-50 on, but Jack Jones is so talented, and he always finds a way to, you know, be close to or around the ball to make the play. I want to give him the benefit of the doubt.
It was backup cornerbacks who. I don't want to say cost Arizona State, because losing is a team effort, but two touchdown catches right on Jack Jones and Tamarcus Davis hitting the holder. And so, I mean, it might be time to show a little bit more faith in the date that brought you to the dance.
Oh, I don't disagree with that.
But I will give you that Jack Jones is one of the most talented defensive backs that Arizona State has had.
Ever.
Yeah. Yeah, ever. he's special. It's just not one his night, and I do feel like it was. You know who I feel like Arizona State's missing right now, and people are going to think this is ridiculous because he never did anything in an Arizona State uniform. But the Jalen Bates grad transfer, I feel like an edge rusher off the defensive, because I don't even know where George Lee is or what he's doing. Jermaine Lole isn't getting to the quarterback. The transfer, Roe Wilkins, is not doing all that much. DJ Davidson can't do all this stuff by himself. Where is Shannon Foreman? What is he doing? Like, what are these guys? How are they regressing?
There's a mess of problems at the front of the defense. There's a mess of problems amongst the defensive line. And, you know, if our defensive line can get to the quarterback or create some sort of pressure or collapse the pocket or whatever, maybe we don't see these touchdowns given up by Jack Jones.
What probably the most painful thing in the world is watching Drake Jackson as a true freshman tear up Utah all by himself. And then watching Arizona State not be able to get to the quarterback when a guy who was very, very close to committing to Arizona State ultimately, you know, fulfilled his dad's dream and went USC, which happens with so many SoCal kids. But yeah, the defensive line is going to have to find a way to maybe be a little bit more creative, or they're going to have to blitz some of these linebackers. And they were doing a little bit of blitz. I saw Jack Jones try to go between guard and center at one point, try to sneak through, you know?
Yeah.
But I
don't see that working very often. But. Yeah,
it's a big football field, and there's a lot of space to make plays if you're not hitting the quarterback, and that's what happened tonight. Special teams, Ayuk didn't really have much of a chance to do anything in the return game. We are 5-6 years into the Sean Slocum experiment, and they haven't really ever settled on a returner or been able to make any plays, but the kicking and punting has always been solid. Zendejas misses a field goal tonight. Still no Brandon Reese.
It's a 48-yard field goal, though.
I heard a lot of people say, like, Wally Pipp, yada, yada, yada. Brandon Reese not going to get his job back because Christian Zendejas was doing everything right. Well, now, tonight, he misses a field goal. With Brandon Reese is healthy, do you let him get a shot? Or do you have Zendejas as a short yardage guy and Brandon Reese as a long? Can Brandon Reese even get into a rhythm if he's only kicking 45-plus yard field goals? What do you do if you're Arizona State?
Well, I mean, Brandon Reese, for people that... I mean, I know people are familiar, but for people that aren't familiar, Brandon Reese is the Steph Curry of kickers. Like, he wants to be, you know, 6 or 7 steps behind the three-point line and hit his three-pointers. He wants to just cross half-court and hit those three-pointers. And, like, that's the type of kicker Brandon Reese is. He's that long-distance guy. So, yeah, you know, if you got two kickers on scholarship, you got to make them both work for it. I mean, those scholarships are being used. So use Zendejas for the short game, the under 35-yard stuff, and then, you know, use Ruiz for the – for the long stuff, for the 48-yarders. Do I think that Brandon would have made that 48-yarder? Yes, I do. Do I think that Zendejas should lose his job? No, I don't. Let Ruiz handle kickoffs and the long-distance stuff, and let Zendejas do all the extra points and, you know, all the short stuff.
That's going to bring this podcast to a close. Arizona State outscores Colorado 31-20 in the final three quarters, and it's not enough to get the job done. For Chili, I am Ralph Amsden. This has been the Devil Train Podcast. Keep it tuned. We will be back with a preview episode of the California game. It's going to be played on a Friday. So be looking for the preview episode, thinking probably Wednesday around noon that will drop. Appreciate everyone who listens. Make sure to subscribe to Arizona Sportscast on iTunes to get these delivered directly to your iPhone if you have one. It's also available on Podbean and SoundCloud. If you live with a heart of gratitude, the world is a wondrous place. We are out.
The devil's train is long and black. It rides the rails of fear. It's heading for destruction now with a drunken engineer. Oh, Lord, please stop that devil's train before it is too late. And teach them how to bow their heads before they seal their fate. Oh, listen to that whistle scream like echoes from the gloom. The throttle's wide, she's spouting steam. She's on her